So should I keep my
Put your mic.
Good morning, all of you. Welcome to the last day of CCMB Virtual Open Week 2020. We have been celebrating this whole week on behalf of the CSIR Foundation Day, which was established 78 years ago on this day. So today we have our first presentation from Dr. Manjula Reddy's lab, where they work on the bacteria cell wall. Let's begin the session with, we have our presenters for today, Bhargavi and Vaidehi, who are PhD students in Dr. Reddy's lab. So over to Bhargavi.
Hi everyone, welcome to the last day of our virtual Open Week event. Hope you all enjoyed the work shared and the interactions in the previous sessions. And I even hope that you are equally enthusiastic and looking forward for today's sessions too. We are from Dr. Manjula Reddy's lab at CCMB. Myself, Bhargavi and Vaidehi are here representing our lab's work in today's event. If we had to say about our lab work, just in few words, we would like to say that it is battle with superbugs. Sounds interesting, right? So now I have a question for you all. Can we see all the living creatures that exist with our naked eye? No, not at all. We humans cannot see particles that are smaller than 50 to 60 microns. But there are lots of organisms on this earth which are far, far less than the limit of our naked eye. Oh no, then are we missing out on our tiny friends? I wonder, if they are not visible, then how do we see them? So here, I present you a picture of a person whose invention made us to embrace the beauty of micro and nano world. He is the father of microbiology, Antoine van Leeuwenhoek. And he was born on 24th October 1632 in Dutch Republic. At the age of 16, he joined as an apprentice at a draper's shop where he wanted to observe the quality of thread using the magnifying glasses of that time. So during this time, he developed his interest in lens making, which actually led him to the invention of a microscope. So this is the picture of the microscope he used. And here I present the illustrations of his observations. So he called all his observations as animalcules. So during his experiments and observations, he reported all his things to the Royal Society in London. And then later the Royal Society in London published his groundbreaking work in their journal. And from then he captured the society's attention and continuously communicated his observations to the society. So he's the first microscopist and the first microbiologist. So this is all about the initial things. Now we know so much more about them. Let's see what it is. So there are different kinds of microorganisms, and they are bacteria, fungi, protozoa, and algae. So out of these four kingdoms, we chose to work on bacteria. Microbes are part of our life more than we know. So we have microorganisms which are very helpful in our daily life, like organisms which are helpful in making probiotics like curd and cheese making and beverage industries. Along with them, even we have microorganisms which do help us in making antibiotics. But at the same time, as the coins have two sides, even we have harmful microorganisms too, which leads to the disease. So let us see. Bacteria come like just like microorganisms, even bacteria do come in all shapes and sizes. So it's like coccus round-shaped and in pairs, diplococci, rod-shaped bacillus, and many more as shown in the picture. Now, Escherichia coli, which is found in our gut, is the model organism that we study. So E. coli is rod-shaped. Here I present the general structure of E. coli rod-shaped bacteria. So in this, we can see the DNA floating in cytoplasm, which is surrounded by a lipid layer called as inner membrane. And next to that, we have a peptidoglycan layer. And then next to that, we have an outer membrane. So this E. coli is a gram-negative bacteria and has got three layers. And the space between this outer membrane and the inner membrane is called periplasm. And the peptidoglycan layer, which is present in between these two outer layers, outer membrane and inner membrane, is the structure that gives shape, rigidity, and which protects the cell from the osmotic pressure that is being created in the cytoplasm. And now, these structures are called as flagellum, which are actually helpful in the motility of the bacteria. So this is all the structure of bacteria in general. And now let us look into the structure of membrane in a little more detail. So as I told, it has got outer membrane, peptidoglycan layer in the periplasm and the inner membrane. Now this peptidoglycan is composed of glycan strands and the peptide bond and the peptides, which are cross-linked. Now, during the cell expansion, the outer membrane has to expand and even the inner membrane has to expand. Along with those two membranes, even this peptidoglycan layer has to expand. But just like outer membrane and inner membrane, it is not so flexible to expand because it has got some glycosidic bonds and the peptide bonds in between. So in order for the expansion of this peptidoglycan, these bonds has to be broken down. So once broken down, the space will be generated. And once the space is generated, it has to be filled up with the new peptidoglycan monomers. Now, let us look into detail, a little more detail, like video. How does this process happen? How does the bacterial cell elongate? So till now I have demonstrated, and now I'll show you a small video. So when it is the time for cell elongation, hydrolases, a class of enzymes make the gaps, as I told you in the previous slide. And next, the ones that fills these gaps are called synthases. So now let us look at the video. In this video, we can see two things, right? The blue color continuous strands and the red color bonds. So the blue color ones are called as glycan strands and the red colors is peptide chains, peptide bonds. So now we can see that some molecules from the bottom are making the gaps and some other molecules are inserting the green color new strand. So the ones which are making the gaps are called hydrolases and the ones which are filling the gaps are nothing but synthases. And now this is the three-dimensional view of how a cell elongation and the insertion of new PZ happens during the cell division. So, as I told you that this is the structure, PG is the structure which gives the rigidity and axial protection for a cell, right? For a bacterial cell. So, and also I told you that we have helpful organisms and harmful organisms too. So if we want to target harmful organisms, this is the best molecule to target and get rid of the harmful bacteria. Now, so you might have heard the term antibiotics. Now let us look at some of the antibiotics. Many antibiotics target different stages of cell wall synthesis. And now let us look at few of them. So now, I told you that PG has to be inserted. For that process, PG precursor molecules has to be made in the cytoplasm. So now antibiotics called fosfomycin and tunicamycin are the ones which targets these PG precursors that are being made in the cytoplasm and inhibits the PG synthesis. And the next class of antibiotics even do target the PG precursors, but they do target while the PG precursors are being inserted into the newly synthesizing PG strands. And the example among them is ramoplanin. And the next one, as we have seen that there is a very long glycan chain in the peptidoglycan layer. So even we have antibiotics which do target this glycan chain attachment to. So example is moinomycin. And finally, targeting the entire structure. So that is peptidoglycan. These are called as beta lactams. And examples are penicillin and vancomycin. So they actually target the cross-linking that which actually gives the rigidity to this PG layer. We have seen multiple classes of antibiotics and many more are known till now. But still, the bacteria are attaining the resistance towards these antibiotics at a very faster rate, unimaginable rate. Now, let us look, see how it is. Increasing antibiotic resistance is a very serious problem. So as it is shown in the first picture, this is a lawn of bacterial culture in which they have placed discs of few drugs, and almost in all the cases, we could see a very clear zone of clearance around each and every disc, which says that this bacterial lawn is susceptible to almost all these drugs. But whereas in the case of this second plate, we could just see that A, B, C, D have got a little good zone of clearance around them, around these drugs. But whereas E, F, G have got a little more less zone of clearance. And finally, H, I, J, K, L haven't got any zone of clearance around them, which says that this bacteria has attained resistance to all these H, I, J, K, L drugs. That means the bacteria is attaining this resistance at an unexpected rate. So there is an urgent need to understand the bacterial cell wall process to make the novel targets for newer antibiotics. And this is what we majorly concentrate on in our lab. So till now, we just have discussed that through antibiotics, we can actually target the bacteria. So in this case, we are targeting the bacteria once they are entered into our body. And even we have, as every problem has multiple solutions, even we have one more solution too. Let's look at it. So if we don't allow them to colonize, there is no need to take the antibiotics, right? So how do we do them? It is through probiotics, another class of useful microorganisms. And my friend Vaidehi will continue on that. Thank you.
Hello. Good morning, everybody. And thank you for that beautiful explanation, Bhagavi. I'm sure it was very educational to everybody listening. Now, as we know, there is a saying that prevention is always better than a cure. And that can pretty much define how probiotics act. As Bhagavi aptly put, these are the good bacteria that don't allow harmful bacteria which cause diseases to colonize in our body. Now let's learn a little bit more about what these probiotics are and how they work. So as this picture depicts, these probiotics are good bacteria that are found in many of the foods that we eat every day, such as yogurt and bread, etc. Many times, or most of the times I should say, they are found in fermented foods. And why, how do they work? For that, we have to understand what microbiota is. Microbiota means all the bacteria that are present on our body. In fact, microbes, that is why we think that microbes are closer to us than we think. If we are talking about humans, and not just humans, in case of all the animals, now we know that bacteria are present in almost all parts of the body. In humans, they are present on our skin, in our nasal passage, in our mouth, on our teeth. And it is also proven that they are present in our digestive tract, mainly gut microbiome. So the bacteria, all the bacteria that are present in our digestive tract are part of our gut microbiome. And one interesting fun fact is that we actually have more bacteria in our body than the cells are there. So if people have actually calculated the number, and that's just an estimate, that we might have more than 10 times the number of bacteria than the number of cells in our body. But there is a big problem while I'm researching these bacteria. And that problem is that most of them cannot be grown under normal laboratory conditions. So we are not able to study them very efficiently. That is why these are called VBNCs, viable but not culturable organisms. Now, this microflora depends on multiple factors. It depends on what kind of food we eat, because many of the bacteria are present on that food itself, or they come after our body tries to metabolize that food. Our microbiota can change due to the medicines we take. For example, if you have ever been ill and you have been prescribed a course of antibiotics, you will find that these antibiotics not only target the harmful bacteria, they also end up killing the good bacteria that are present in our body. So after this course of medicine, it is found that often our microflora changes. Then it depends on geography. As we go to different places, it is obvious that the environment will also change. The kind of microorganisms we come into contact with also changes, and that leads to a change in the composition of our microbiota as well. It also changes with lifestyle. So if we are talking about younger kids who often play outside and play with their friends, they often come into more contact with bacteria that are present in soil, etc., as compared to adults who spend most of their time working indoors in offices. Now, these two, stress is known to cause a change in microbiota, and there are lots and lots of studies coming up nowadays which say that my microbiota in turn influences our stress levels in as well. So that link is actually called as gut microbiota and brain axis, where people are finding out that bacteria in our stomach and gut can actually affect the functions of our brain, and how they have been found to have a link in lots of psychological disorders such as anxiety, depression, metabolic disorders, etc., etc. Now, the last two points I can come to are birthing process and infant feeding method. So, to be honest, there have been studies coming up which say that the babies that are born by natural deliveries, as compared to the babies that are born after a cesarean section, have changes in their microbiota, because babies actually acquire some of these good bacteria from their mother's vagina as they are being born. The same happens with infant feeding. So babies also get a lot of antibodies and good bacteria through breast milk, which they are not able to get exposed to when they are fed with infant formula or artificial milk or store-bought milk. Now, moving on to how sources of probiotics. So by now, we know that these good bacteria have such a big role in maintaining the proper functioning of our body. So let's take a look at where we can get them. First, easiest source is natural sources. They are often present in the different kinds of food we eat, such as dairy, yogurt, then salads, some sort of pickles, even fermented foods that India's favorite fermented foods, such as idli and dosa. If a doctor gives you a course of antibiotic for some disease, we see that they also prescribe us to drink some probiotic supplements like Yakult, or take these some capsules such as Porlac. So these capsules are compounds usually contain a mixture of different probiotics, and these are some of the strains of bacteria which are commonly used as probiotics. So the probiotics that are currently present in market don't contain a single bacterium. Most of the times they're a mixture of two or more of these species. So if you take one tablet, that usually has spores of these bacteria, which are inactive forms. And once they go into our body, they germinate, and then live bacteria come out of it, and they start replicating and start giving us with their benefits. But how exactly are these bacteria beneficial to us? They help us in multiple ways, some of which I talked about when I was talking about the gut microbiota. But to put it simply, these bacteria can help us digest the different kinds of food that we eat. So moving on to a fun fact, how many of you are aware that humans are probably the only animals that can drink milk into adulthood? And we have these bacteria to thank for that. So these probiotics help in breaking down the milk compounds, and then the body can use them to get nutrition. And many times, if such bacteria are not present in the body, people can end up being allergic to dairy products. Then these bacteria help by extracting more metabolism. They help in the body's metabolism by extracting energy from the food we consume. They also produce some helpful vitamins, such as it is known that these gut bacteria and probiotic bacteria help in production of B12 vitamin, and thus, which is extremely important for proper functioning of the body. They help in they help in eliminating various toxins from your gut. And the most important role is they help, they compete with the bad bacteria or pathogenic bacteria that may enter your body. That happens because that is a game of numbers, basically. If we have more of the good bacteria, and then they can crowd up in your intestinal membrane, and they don't let pathogenic bacteria stay there for a long time. And if this pathogenic bacteria can't stay there for a long time, they cannot infect our body and cause disease. That's why probiotics are often known as prevention of a disease. They are helpful in prevention of a disease. And they also help in maintaining the intestinal wall integrity, which pretty much acts in the same way. So many of the pathogenic bacteria that cause some stomach infections, such as dysentery, typhoid, etc., often break down the, often compromise the integrity of intestinal wall by secreting some toxins. So as these probiotics don't let them bind to the intestinal wall, cells of the intestinal wall, and make sure that these bacteria, harmful bacteria, are eliminated quickly, they also help in maintaining the intestinal wall integrity. And as a result of all of these functions, the cumulative effect is that we have a healthier host, which is us. But as I mentioned previously, it is very difficult to study these microbiota because we can't culture them like other bacteria in the lab. So since microbiology is an old science, we can say, it's an old branch of biology, as Bhagavi mentioned, people have been studying these tiny bacteria since almost 150 or 200 years. So we have developed a lot of techniques to grow them in our laboratories and do some experiments to study how they grow and how they divide, etc., etc. But since we don't have enough tools to grow all of these gut microbiota, and in fact, I would like to say that many of the gut members of this gut microbiota are still in the dark. We don't know the exact number of species and their details still today. So scientists have to come up with more and more creative ideas to figure out how we can study them effectively and gain more information about them. So that's like shining a torch in the dark areas. And in this particular example, that's pretty much what they have done literally. So here in the bottom slide, you can see these pretty pictures of bacteria which are colored in green, red, yellow, etc. And for that, this study was actually published earlier this month in the first week of September in the journal Scientific Advances. I'm not sure about the journal, but we have cited it here. So if you're interested, you can actually go look up the paper and read more about it. Now, I'll talk a little more about how they have managed to color these bacteria into these pretty colors. So what they have done, they have used fluorescently tagged amino acids to give these beautiful colors. As Bhargavi explained previously, peptidoglycan is a big molecule which has a lot of short chains. A part of these short chains are amino acids. These are molecules called amino acids. And these scientists have actually managed to tag these amino acids with different fluorescent proteins, which have different color, which allows them to, and the idea is that they first tag the amino acids with a green colored protein, green colored tag, and feed these to the mice. So once these mice eat the fluorescently tagged proteins, they will start metabolizing them. And whatever bacteria are present in the gut of these mice will start taking up these fluorescently tagged green amino acids and start incorporating them in their cell wall. So that part of the cell wall, which has been newly formed after injecting these green colored dyes, starts become fluorescing in green color. If they wait for some 3 hours after this first injection, it's not an injection, actually they are giving this orally. After 3 hours, they wait so that there is sufficient time for the bacteria to incorporate these green tagged amino acids. Then they provide a red tagged amino acids using this particular fluorophore in the same way by oral gavage. They wait 3 more hours after that. Now, by this time, the bacteria in the gut of the same mouse have used up the green type amino acid for their replication of their cell wall. But now they have more raw material in the form of these red tagged amino acids. So they start incorporating these red tags. So they are again given sufficient time to replicate, in which is 3 hours. After that, the scientist collected their cecal microbiota and then checked by fluorescent microscopy which of the amino acids got incorporated where. And that led them to discovery of such beautiful patterns. So here we can see that the parts of the cell wall, which are colored green, had started dividing first. And then those which were colored red were starting divided later because the mice got red colored amino acids later on. And as we can see here in the drawings, we can see that each bacterium divides in a different way, in a different pattern. So scientists were also able to track that pattern, that they are not the same. There is an immense variety of bacteria in the gut microbiota, and all of them divide in a particular way, which is sufficient, which can actually be used for their identification. So later in the study, scientists do exactly that. They try to classify the bacteria based on their patterns of division with the help of these pictures obtained after fluorescence microscopy. So this is one new interesting method which scientists have come up with to help us in classifying the members of our gut microbiota. But still, as I said, it's a developing field and we still don't have a lot of techniques for characterization. So there is a huge amount of scope for further research in this field. And so we can all work. If any of you are interested in getting into research about this area, you can also think about the new creative ways to characterize the microbiota. So that's all for now. And what the take-home message from this story of probiotics can be that you are what you eat, and that's why you are your microbes. Now, don't go away anywhere, because we have actually made a short quiz for you guys to check if you liked our presentation and if you were paying attention or not. So please go to www.menti.com. and enter this code given here to start the quiz and participate. Please do participate.
Yes. Now let's start the quiz. Let us see in the main presentation once. I stopped it. Wait.
Hello everyone. So people who have questions can raise their hands, and when they are asked to be, they can question, put their question in the YouTube comment section, and they can ask here also. Amrish Rai, yeah, you can unmute yourself and ask the question.
Hello.
Yeah, hello, ma'am.
Actually, I just want to know that.
Hello. Hi, Amrish. Can you repeat your question?
I just want to know that, does these beneficial bacteria, so-called probiotics, have some role in regulating metabolism of an individual, like low metabolic rate in obese people and high metabolic rate in the thinner people?
Yes. So there are studies coming up quite recently in the last 5 years or so, that say that these gut bacteria in our body do play a role in regulating our metabolism. And people actually have compared the composition of bacteria in overweight people and underweight people. And they have found out that overweight people and underweight people have different compositions as compared to healthy individuals. So we can say that they do play some role, although mechanism is unknown.
Okay.
And probiotics are also supposedly helpful in this matter, because they can restore your microbiome composition to the normal composition. So they can be helpful in treatment of these conditions.
Okay, so I got the title that battle against the superbugs, but in whole presentation there is not a single definition of superbugs. So will you please elaborate this? What are the superbugs?
Superbugs, to put it simply, are the bacteria that have become resistant to multiple antibiotics, so or drugs. So even the combination of 2-3 antibiotics is not helpful in treating them. And if you are interested, you can actually go to the website of World Health Organization and look it up. So they have proposed a list of 6-7 such pathogens which are resistant to multiple drugs. And these are called superbugs. And these inspections are currently thought to be most difficult in treating the conditions.
Okay, so in this list, this mycobacterium tuberculosis comes this list?
Yes, I think it does.
Yeah, okay, thank you. I
hope we were helpful.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. Anybody else? Please raise your hand. If anybody else wants to ask any question, raise your hand. It seems we don't have any more questions, so we'll end the session here. Please fill the feedback forms that I have pasted in the chat box, and let us know what you thought of this session. And that feedback form is also there in the YouTube. Oh, we have another Amrish. You want to ask again? I'll unmute you.
Yeah. Basically, I have seen in the presentation that the main target is the synthesis of cell wall here as a synthesis of antibiotic drug. So, how the bacteria getting that resistance if we synthesize any drug for the cell wall synthesis?
See, that's the beauty of this. I suppose I can use the beauty. Basically, bacteria replicate much faster than us. And when they are under a condition such as stressful, which is made stressful because of antibiotics, what happens is that often they develop, adapt to the environment in such a way which lets them to divide in even in the presence of antibiotics. And sometimes what happens is that patients don't complete the course of antibiotic or take it properly.
I know that already, but yeah. I know at the molecular level what happened there. If we target a drug at a cell wall synthesis, and after getting a drug, the bacteria getting resistance for that drug.
Sorry, I didn't understand. What exactly are you trying to ask?
I want to know that how the bacteria getting resistance against the drug which are synthesized for that, blocking the synthesis of cell wall of bacteria. Hello?
Yeah, just a second. One second. Suraj, do you want to take this? So my colleague here will answer your question, I think.
Yeah, there is a possible explanation for this. So when a bacteria uses some machinery to synthesize its cell wall, suppose there are other bacteria, there are other variants of bacteria are also in that environment. So when we target specific machinery, that bacteria in successive division, it sometimes takes DNA from other bacteria through different processes, like you might have read conjugation and so that the drug we have designed for the previous machinery won't work for a different variant which that bacteria got from a different bacteria. So they become resistant in that way. And also there are other molecular explanations, and we don't target only cell wall. There are antibiotics for different processes, like translation and translation process also. It's not only cell.
Yeah, I know that, but I'm at this time, I just want to know for the cell wall particularly.
Actually, that's the problem. There are thousands of different variants of single type of bacteria, like one genus of bacteria. So they get different variants of that genes through their, we can say their sexual reproduction.
Yeah, okay. We are targeting a drug which ruptures the cell wall of the bacteria. But after a time that bacteria getting resistance and we are unable to rupture that cell wall. So I want to know that what is at molecular level, at the biochemical and enzymatic level happens there, which the bacteria getting acquired to make its own cell wall again.
So Amrish, one answer can be that the cell wall of the resistant bacteria might not be exactly similar to the cell wall of the sensitive bacterium. So there are certain enzymes that bacteria produce, for example, beta lactamases, which degrade the antibiotics themselves. And they also make small changes in their structure of the cell wall so that the antibiotics that we are providing are not able to bind to the cell wall and inhibit its replication.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, hope that was able to clear your doubts.
Yeah. It's sufficient. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, if we don't have any more questions, we'd like to end this session because we have a second session starting from 11, which talks about cell membranes and GPCRs and how their biology is going to be very interesting. So please tune in. And I have already pasted the feedback form links in MS Teams and YouTube. So please fill that. Thanks again for attending.
Thank you all.